All right, now, what is the number one key issue of importance? Stay engaged with spiritual truth. Stay engaged with spiritual truth. That is the number one. Because if we don't do that, how can we then manage our success? Number two is managing our success. So the 1-2 punch is staying engaged with spiritual truth. Stay engaged with it. That's the number one discipline in this life. Above every other discipline, number one responsibility, stay engaged with spiritual truth. Stay engaged with it. However you can, you have to stay engaged with it. Number two is managing your success on the path, managing the wow of it, because you will move towards success, actually. And success is a big deal. It's a really big deal for us. So those are the two. Staying engaged, managing your success. Staying engaged, managing success. So what I'm trying to do in these videos is help the world out with this. And it's, you know, it's by every day, trying to every day staying engaged and somehow find a way to engage with spiritual truth. This is the challenge that we have here in this world. This is our challenge. It's not climbing Mount Everest. Okay, that's not our challenge. It's not being some fitness guru. That's not our challenge. Our challenge is staying engaged with spiritual truth here. That is our challenge. That's the challenge the Holy Spirit gives us. And that's what it points it out to us. I mean, that is our challenge. And it Holy Spirit helps us stay engaged with spiritual truth. That's one of the ways the Holy Spirit helps us. And since that's our most important responsibility and challenge, that's the key element. If you are staying engaged with spiritual truth, considering it, then the Holy Spirit's helping you out a lot. Okay. And you may have a different way of being engaged. You may not be a gypsy traveling all over, giving seminars and being, you know, big shot. And you may not be like St. Paul, all right? Traveling all over the place, spreading the gospel and becoming historically known as I'm the one who spread this all over the world. Keep in mind that St. Paul spread Pauline Christianity, his own interpretation of it, which isn't necessarily everyone's interpretation of it. So you may not be doing that. You may be just sitting, like I'm just sitting here, and nobody knows in much of the world at large. I'm just staying in one place, like a householder, okay? It's just staying in one place, hunkered down in a cave. But at least trying to be a cheerleader to everyone in the world by saying, you know, engage with your challenge in this world. Engage with your challenge. Otherwise, you'll have another life and you'll have to engage with it there. I keep kicking the can down the road. It's no good. You know, say, well, next life, mañana. What a bummer that is, right? So stay engaged with it now is the key. Now, when do you engage with the spiritual truth? Now, right now. And we've had great teachers in this world tell us this is our only responsibility here, really, is to stay engaged with spiritual truth. That's our responsibility. And if we don't meet it this life, we'll have another life for sure. And if we don't do it then, we'll have another and another and another and another. So how do you bring all these wretched lives? How do you stop returning, getting a return ticket? Stay engaged with spiritual truth this life, right now. And this is what I try to do. And of course, the ego tries to disengage you from it. We have this adversary which tries to make us irresponsible, which is to disengage from spiritual truth. So what we have to do is we hear this knocking on our door. We hear the knocking on the door, and it's a soft knocking, and we have to pay attention. Say, who's knocking at our door? What's knocking at our door? What's knocking at our door? Well, spiritual truth is knocking at our door. And so we say, hey, maybe I should open the door. This is consideration. This is giving consideration to spiritual truth. Maybe I should open the door. Then say, well, why am I not opening the door? Why am I reluctant? Is that stupid? Why don't I? This is spiritual consideration. We hear the knocking at the door, and then we say, okay, let me answer it. And then something tells us, why do you want to answer it? I say, what do you mean? I want to answer it. No, you shouldn't answer it. And we say, I want to, but I feel a lot of pressure not to. Why I feel this pressure? Why don't I answer the door? And so you go through this struggle, because the ego is trying to, which is our own arrogance, spiritual arrogance. Really, the ego is really just all the defenses, all the camouflage for our spiritual arrogance, which we believe we can arrogate to God qualities that God did not give to itself. This is spiritual arrogance. So the ego tries to distract us away from answering the door or even paying any attention to it. The ego says, don't pay attention to that. Don't pay attention to that. What knock? And the ego says, I didn't hear any knocking. You know, what are you talking about? It's a gentle knocking. It's a gentle knocking at the door. Gentle knocking. Very soft little knock. Knock, 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 knock. Knock, 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 knock. This morning, truth was knocking at my door. And I paid attention to it. We woke up from a bunch of crazy dreams. And I said, wow, that's not really helping me. What in the world is all that about? And then I said, well, let me just try to connect with spiritual truth. And I started to work at it. And lo and behold, I began to recognize something very important. Made a lot of progress. And then there's sort of a wow reaction to that, right? It's like, wow, I really am able to look at this. That's great. Let's say you hear a knocking on the door, and you start to go to open that door, and then you realize, wow, I'm really going towards opening the door. That's tremendous progress, and you'll feel a wow about it, and that will stop you, temporarily kind of stop you. That's okay. That's part of the situation, is we have to break the inertia of not answering the knock at the door. What I got this morning was spaciousness, pure spaciousness. I began to focus on that. And I realized this is where it's at, actually. This is really where it's at. Anytime you can put your attention on pure spaciousness, that's an extremely good focus to have, tremendous focus. We often don't get there. The ego manages to distract us away from that because it knows its goose is cooked if we get our attention onto pure spaciousness. But above and above all else, above and beyond all else, is stay engaged with your spiritual path, your consideration of answering that knock on the door every day. As much as possible, stay engaged with it. And the ego will fight you tooth and nail, trying to distract you away from it, for sure. The ego says, you don't need to accept God as God is. We're going to be able to change God. You see, our camouflaging of arrogance is actually causative, and it's causing arrogance to now have effects on God. So you need to get used to the new God, the changed God. That's what the ego tells us. And we need to say, no, that's a lie. That our arrogance has had no effect on God. So camouflaging it doesn't change arrogance in any way. And I need to accept God as God is. So spaciousness. We're very unskilled at looking at spaciousness. We don't practice it. We don't practice it in our education system. We don't practice it in our family. We don't practice it at our work. We don't practice it in any way, actually, in the world. And so we're clumsy about it. We're clumsy. And yet we can become a little more coordinated about it, a little less clumsy. And that's very helpful. But how to talk about it, where I realize that very few have any real facility in this. And we feel lost at sea. You immediately feel, well, I don't understand. When we start talking about spaciousness. Pure spaciousness. The pure spaciousness we're talking about is, for example, a desk, a chair, the ground, everything in your room, everything outside, the walkways, the roads, and the air, the atmosphere, the space, the cosmic space. All of this has an equal relationship to pure spaciousness. All of this is mere appearance in pure spaciousness. There's no difference about the appearance of a table as there is the appearance of space, cosmic space, in pure spaciousness. Or air, or atmosphere. There's no difference at all. Just like there's no difference between dirt, the ground. The ground is occupying, is abiding, is an appearance in spaciousness. The same as light is an appearance in spaciousness. The same as space is an appearance in pure spaciousness. Now, nothing has any spaciousness of its own. Nothing is generating any spaciousness of its own at all. This is another very important aspect. And this is like reversed of what we, the example we just gave about space. We can look at space and we say, okay, is that generating its own spaciousness? And then we look at like the dirt, the ground, a rock, a boulder, and we think, wow, that's very solid. It's generating its own spaciousness somehow. But there's no difference at all between both. Are just mere appearances. But don't struggle with this. Okay, we realize we're clumsy with this, so we don't get agitated at our clumsiness early. The answer creeps up on us, and we're able to see better and better and better as we work at it, what we're talking about. Nothing generates its own spaciousness. Okay, there is nothing, no appearance generates any spaciousness at all. Has absolutely no generative quality whatsoever in terms of spaciousness. It's just an appearance. In other words, it's mere appearance and pure spaciousness. Nothing else. Nothing else. A boulder, a massive wall, rock wall like Yosemite or some huge, that doesn't generate any spaciousness, and nor does it detract. It neither generates nor does it detract, neither adds nor subtracts one iota from pure spaciousness. Space, cosmic space also, neither generates nor subtracts one iota from pure spaciousness. So there's no difference in the mere appearance-ness of pure, of cosmic space, that we, meaning the space of the universe, space that this world is seems to be abiding in, you know, surrounded by cosmic space, there's no difference whatsoever from that to a huge, massive granite boulder. Neither adds nor subtracts one iota from pure spaciousness. Now, we might say, well, what does this have to do with me, the body, enlightenment? Well, the truth be told, in reality, the body has no role whatsoever. There aren't any bodies. I'm not a body. I'm free. I'm still spirit exactly as God created me. Bodies are just a way that we've developed to try and camouflage our arrogance. That's all. The bodies have absolutely nothing to do with reality. There's no bodies in reality. It's mere appearance, mere appearance. But the body, we think that we, our perspective is we own some spaciousness, our regenerating spaciousness. We can own it. We cannot own spaciousness. The idea of ownership of spaciousness is something that really people are profoundly deluded in. We get the impression that spaciousness can be divided off, can be subdivided. Cannot. It's absolutely seamless. What you can say is all has all. All owns all, actually. There is no subdivision of pure spaciousness at all. Nothing adds nor subtracts, nor does it generate any spaciousness at all. So nothing can say, well, I have my own spaciousness, I'm generating. That's not true. Nothing is generating its own spaciousness. Everything is permeated, everything is saturated, both inside and outside, by pure spaciousness, equally. And there's no division between the inside and the outside in terms of pure spaciousness at all. So when we look at a thing, we see a difference between the inside of it and the outside of it. Inside is that's the thing, and outside of it is cosmic space. But in terms of pure spaciousness, there's no inside or outside. There's no seam at all. So if there's no seams, how can we claim ownership? If there's no differentiation, how can we claim ownership? Totally arbitrary. It doesn't exist in reality, any ownership of pure spaciousness. So it's seamless and utterly, totally smooth and seamless, pure spaciousness. Now there's no question that the times that I've been able to get free of delusion momentarily is because I've been focusing on spaciousness. That's absolutely so. So it is very encouraging if you're able to, your attention turns to spaciousness, pure spaciousness. This is like the fruit of the path. And yet we don't struggle trying to fit things together. Keep in mind that pure spaciousness is not something that we fit together. It's not something that we take this part and this part and this part, or we have this segment of it and that segment of it, and then we need to fit them together. There are no segments. There's no ownership. There's no generation of spaciousness. Things are not generating the spaciousness that they're abiding in. Again, there's no seam between a thing and, you know, between inside and outside. There's no seam in pure spaciousness between the inside and the outside of something. No seam at all. There's no change at all. It's all abiding in spaciousness, isn't it? Entirely. So the discipline is to be able to look at this, even though you can't really, you're not really sure, how do I put this together? You don't put it together so much. Pure spaciousness isn't something that's put together. We're so used to building things that we think anything has value is something that's put together, right? Our clothing, as our clothes, we value our clothing, it's been put together, right? Our homes have been built, put together. Our roads, our cars have been put together. Our bodies seem to be a massively complex, you know, putting together of these various systems. So we value putting things together. All right. Whereas in pure spaciousness, there are no thing. There's no thingness to pure spaciousness. There's nothing to put together as one seamless whole. And so we tend to not value it. But that's literally our reality, our identity, our one identity, our reality. And this putting stuff together is our arrogance, actually. So in our mind, though, the valuing of putting things together, for instance, like a house, is, seems so valuable to us that we devalue the vision of oneness, the vision of pure spaciousness. We say, well, where's the value? It's what can you build with that? You don't need to build anything with it. It already includes everything. It's already all-inclusive. From the standpoint of a body, it doesn't seem to be very important. But keep in mind, bodies play no role in reality whatsoever. None. So stay engaged here. You know, this is the key to it, is you don't put it together. It's not something that you put together. And this is why we tend to get frustrated and say, wait a minute, I'm trying to build something here and I'm not getting anywhere. Give me the lumber, give me the nails, I want to build something. No, it's more like we're not building anything. Letting go of the emphasis on building anything. Nothing needs to be built in order for pure spaciousness to be seamless and everywhere. Nothing is generating any spaciousness. This can is not generating spaciousness. It's simply abiding in the one spaciousness that is. It's simply abiding in the one pure spaciousness that is. It's not generating it. And wherever we move this, it's not leaving it. It's not getting closer, farther away, leaving it, making it more, making it less, changing it in any way. Nothing is happening to the pure spaciousness. Nothing is happening to it. There's absolutely no change at all taking place. There never is any change taking place in pure spaciousness. There's never any alteration of it. And again, putting our mind on this is actually the highest benefit to us, even though in our valuing we don't see it, right? We've trained ourselves not to see the value of reality, actually. Our arrogance has been in charge of our curriculum. For so long, we've trained ourselves to not value reality. And we shrug our shoulders and say, what's the value of all this? I don't see any value. Because we've trained ourselves not to see it. But it's actually all value. But our training has been very thorough and strong, so we feel little when we look at this. We feel, oh, this isn't important. Why am I wasting my time on this? And you have to use your will to say, no, let us continue to look at this. The more comfortable we get, the easier it is then to see more clearly. We think we have a body identity. The body is generating spaciousness. And everything generates its own spaciousness. That is not true. This body is not generating any spaciousness. We don't have any body identity. There's only one identity, which is pure spaciousness. That's that's not our identity. That is just the one identity that is the one identity. There's only one identity. And everything is it. This is it. Only one identity and everything is it. All is it. All is all. All is the one identity. That can only be understood in terms of pure spaciousness. If we don't recognize pure spaciousness, then we are totally deluded, actually. We're in arrogance, severe arrogance. When we don't occupy special spaciousness, the spaces that we're occupying isn't special. It's no different than the space that any plant is occupying. You know, or we have this tendency to believe that human bodies are special. They're occupying some special spaciousness. Wherever they are, the space is special. That's not true at all. There's no special spaciousness. Only arrogance would see it as special. And bodies are an expression of our arrogance, actually. Spiritual arrogance. There's nothing special at all. But keep in mind, that also means that there's nothing less than, too. You're not less than. Another way of saying it is all is equally special, or all are, but nothing is special, I would say, is a better way to look at it. Everything that appears in mere spaciousness is mere appearance. Is mere appearance, all equally mere appearance. None of it is special, occupying any special zone. Spacious, pure spaciousness doesn't have special zones, special areas. They, oh, well, it's appearing in this area, so it's better or special. And it's our arrogance that doesn't want to see this. It insists we've changed reality. So now there's specialness. Special zones, special places, special people, special things. All of this is the delusion of our spiritual arrogance and believing we can change God. Arrogate to God qualities that God doesn't have. Such a specialness. Yes, I already know that this tree isn't special. Yes, I already know that this hedge isn't special. Yes, I already know this flower isn't special. Yes, I already know this body isn't special. Yes, I already know this can isn't special. Yes, I already know that this space isn't special. Yes, I already know that this planet isn't special. Yes, I already know that this universe isn't special. Yes, I already know that this atom isn't special. Yes, I already know this piece of dust is not special. Yes, I already know that there is no specialness. Yes, I already know that this day isn't special. Yes, I already know that this time isn't special. Yes, I already know that this instant isn't special. Yes, I already know that this hour isn't special. Yes, I already know that this place isn't special. And the, you know, we have this dread of well, how can I be special then? It's not a question, how can I be special? Nothing is special. So we always feel this equality of sameness. And yet we feel that somehow that's robbing us of specialness. But we have to defend our specialness. We feel we need to defend it. Anyway. Nothing is generating any spaciousness. No appearance is interacting or generating or being causative to pure spaciousness at all. It's not having any effect on pure spaciousness. So how can you say it's special? In relation to pure spaciousness, nothing is special. Now, just the audacity to sit here and talk like this . The ego feels this is just extraordinarily audacious and blasphemous, really, because the ego doesn't value this at all. So the ego just sitting there waiting for us to pay attention to what it sees has value. And just sitting here listening to this is very audacious. The ego is just chomping at the bit to get you to do something else. So this is the value of sitting quietly and not doing anything. And paying attention to staying engaged with spiritual truth. Because it's showing that you value it, whereas the ego doesn't value this at all. The ego doesn't value this at all. Sees no value in it. From the standpoint of the ego, we're being revolutionary. We're rebelling against its authority. What is its authority based on? Advising us what is valuable, what it has value, advising us. And of course, we're not listening to its advice right now. Nothing generates its own spaciousness. We think that we're giving birth to life as if we're generating spaciousness. We don't generate spaciousness. No bodies have ever generated spaciousness. Nothing generates spaciousness. You see, spaciousness, pure spaciousness, is an idea. It's an idea. Idea of God. It's a God idea. We can't think of it in a materialistic way. It's just zero-dimensional in terms of materiality. So any appearance is an idea too that arises within the fundamental idea of pure spaciousness, which enables all appearance to appear. And an idea has no dimension to it. So everything appears in this zero-dimensional, infinitely vast matrix, ideational matrix of simply seamless, pure spaciousness with no boundaries, no circumference, no center, no circumference, no boundaries at all. Everything is boundless. All appearance appears in boundlessness. Now, if you're clumsy, what do? You kind of look around first and you kind of say, okay, where's the, I don't want to trip on this, I don't want to trip on this, let me look at this. If you're clumsy, it's best to sit still and look around carefully and see where everything is. So if we're clumsy with this pure spaciousness, looking at it, we just sit here quietly and we're looking around. We're not trying to go too fast here. So this is what will happen in your looking. You have these periods where you just, you know, there's a lot of, you feel like you're going very slow. Very cautious. This cat here is, when it wants to jump up on something, jump up on a tree or something, climb it. First it looks. Then it looks again. Then it kind of gets poised to go, and it's still looking. And once it has got the real picture of it, suddenly the cat will just leap real fast and with great certainty. So we're like that cat. We're just looking at this. The leap will come. The leap really is the leap into recognizing there isn't any leap that anything can make. There's nothing that anything can do. All is mere appearance. There isn't anything to accomplish in reality. Reality is not some design that we put things together, we accomplish something. It's an experiencing, not an accomplishing. There's nothing we can accomplish. This is already true. And also, since there's nothing that can be accomplished, there's no such thing as failure. Failure. How can anything fail to be in pure spaciousness? It's already there. It cannot fail. It cannot not be there. There's nothing to accomplish. So everything is mere appearance and nothing else. So as we go over and over and over this, we get used to it. We get more and more used to it, more familiar with it. And but don't struggle, go slowly. Again, the ego says, well, where's the value? Doesn't see the value. Pure spaciousness is the value. It doesn't need added on value. There's no value to add on to it. Nothing adds any value to pure spaciousness. Nothing adds or takes away either one. So we're so used to getting somewhere in terms of building, going like somewhere, even if we're going somewhere, we think we're going to somewhere special, some different spaciousness. No, it's all the same spaciousness. There's nowhere to go. Nothing to do and nowhere to go in terms of adding or subtracting from it, in terms of accomplishing anything. There's nothing to do in terms of accomplishing anything, of adding value, of subtracting value. Nowhere to go in terms of accomplishing any accomplishment at all. So we say, well, what do? Well, we were told that you're inherently creative and you just enjoy the appearance of everything. Just how everything is appearing. You just simply Jesus said, like a daydream. Just let everything flow like a daydream. Nothing is being accomplished. There's no goal of accomplishment. Creation is not some goal-oriented situation of accomplishment. And since there's nothing to accomplishment, to accomplish there isn't any failure either, right? There's no such thing as failure to accomplish. So, this isn't easy for me, it's not easy for you. Because of the valuing situation, we value our arrogance and believe that our arrogance, we have to maintain the causativeness of it ceaselessly. See, we're bound in this ceaseless effortness. We believe that arrogance is causative, but it has to be maintained through constant accomplishment. And so we're like fixated on accomplishment. And then therefore we value it. We think that's the only way to experience, is we have to believe that we're getting somewhere, that we're becoming more special, that we're creating value, that we're generating spaciousness. All this belief is in order to keep believing that our arrogance is causative and has effect on God. And we believe that's the only way, then this is a new reality, and this is the only way we can experience, is to have goals, be goal fixated, accomplishment fixated, success fixated, going fixated, getting somewhere fixated, putting something together fixated, creating value fixated. All these fixations, we feel if we don't have them, we'll cease to exist. But where can you go to cease to exist? Can you get outside of pure spaciousness? Even the idea of a void abides in pure spaciousness. So we're not chasing after value. The value is already set. The inherent value of creation is already there. What we do is we just enjoy experiencing. We don't add value or subtract value. All value is already present. It's a given. the value is in the setup of reality, how it's all set up. So we're able to have endless experiencing and enjoyment and joy of that. We don't have to worry about generating value, generating spaciousness. We don't have to deal with that in any way. It's not an issue. Now, the benefit of listening to this, hearing this, is that you gradually become more adept at this, whereas those who are frantically pursuing, you know, success, they're illiterate in this way. And being illiterate about pure spaciousness is arrogance. So they're allowing their arrogance to dictate to them what has value. And they believe that pursuing value has value. Whereas we say that value is intrinsic and never can be added to nor subtracted from. And there's nothing we can do to make it more or less. So there's no value to pursuing it. There's no value in pursuit. So we give up the pursuit, the feeling that of pursuit, that we're pursuing it. And of course, we're pursuing it to distract ourselves from the feeling that we're being pursued by an abyss, which is really reality, because we insist we've changed reality, and so we feel, but we haven't. So we still feel that there's something that is pursuing us, trying to drag us into an abyss, but that's not really the case. And so we feel we're, by pursuing value, we're protecting ourselves from that abyss. But that abyss is just our misinterpretation of reality. Because we say we've changed reality, so it can't be an abyss of pure freedom, cannot be there. We just feel that this is some sort of something that we have to deal with successfully, that we can successfully deal with it, but it requires all our efforts to keep believing that we're generating spaciousness. And that protects us from the abyss. And again, and don't be concerned if you're not able to figure it out. It's the just getting used to the general context of this, of talking like this, of looking like this. We're just looking. The ego doesn't value it at all. It mocks it. You know, it says, why is this just spiritual babble? It has no relevance to anything. And we're busy, you know, protecting ourselves from the abyss. That's our new life here. Generating value, generating success, generating identity, generating spaciousness. We have to keep generating the spaciousness so we don't fall into the abyss. That's what arrogance values. So it's better to stay within the general context than try to chase after some insight, struggle to chase after something. Just stay, let it come to you. Don't pursue it. Don't pursue the truth. Because remember, pursuit is our trouble. We think there's something to pursue. So we're just letting truth come to us, as it were, by we stop pursuing success, pursuing value, stop pursuing spaciousness, stop pursuing identity, stop pursuing figuring it out, stop pursuing, and then we allow what's already here to be recognized. Because pursuit implies that there's something chasing you too. I gotta get this. Why? Well, there's some, you know, insecurity chasing me. So full stop would mean we're stopping our pursuit, and then we can recognize we don't need to pursue any value. We already have it. It's total. It's all one value. We cannot throw it away. We cannot lose it. Nothing can. So all this activity of the world is, we feel it's activity of the light that is protecting us from the darkness. We're struggling against falling into the darkness. But remember, what we think is darkness is really the fact that God hasn't changed. And we feel that that is some terrible pit of darkness that we must avoid falling into. Because why? I mean, our arrogance tells us we've changed God. And the fact that we haven't changed God, well, we don't admit that. What we say is we have changed God, and now God is just merely this vast pit of darkness. And yet we have the light, and we're keeping ourselves from falling into it. But we have to keep vigilantly generating, you know, identity, success, spaciousness, have to keep working at it, or else we'll slip into the pit. This is our belief. This is what comes about from arrogance. So the struggle between good and evil, light and dark, this is what we engage with. This is what we, our arrogance leads us into this struggle, into this pursuit. We're pursuing, and as we pursue, we feel that we're being pursued. But if we recognize that our arrogance is non-causative and hasn't changed reality at all, then there is no dark pit to fall into at all. In fact, there's no way you can fall at all. You can't lose intrinsic value. It's impossible. You can't be separate from pure spaciousness. You can't be either inside it nor outside it. There's no inside or outside. Now, only from the standpoint, if we're trying to generate value, generate pure spaciousness, then we see it as an abyss. We see God as an abyss, actually. A place where we were unable to generate spaciousness, unable to generate value, unable to generate that. We feel that's like an abyss where we can't experience it all. This is the mental trick that we're using to cause a fear to ourselves, causing ourselves fear. We don't need to generate spaciousness or value. So it's not an abyss. Look at it that way, it's not an abyss at all. It just depends how you look at it. Right now, the world looks at reality as an extremely fearful abyss that would prevent it from surviving, from being. But keep in mind, the being that we are imagining is only based on our belief we've been able to change reality, and that we're now in the process of attaining perfection so we can be greater than God. So this focus, let's keep this focus. Don't just stay with it here. Don't struggle with it. So really, we're just looking at reality in the wrong way, as if it were an abyss, when in fact it's not. And of course, when we recognize it's not, then what do we have to pursue to avoid it? There's no need for pursuing anything at all. We can just experience right where we are as a flow. And wherever we go, we're right there. We're not in pursuit of anything. We're just floating in this beingness. Now, a wow reaction has come up because we were able to look at the simplicity of the situation, which generates a wow. See, we part of our defenses really is complexity. So we feel very safe as long as what we see looking at appears to be complex. But what we see is very simple, that's when we get nervous. And also that's when we get elated too. That's the wow. Elation and trepidation, a mixture of the two, generates this wow feeling so this has arisen because we were able to look at it in its essential simplicity and clarity here. Yeah, it's like alarm bells go off. It's like, whoa, you just strayed away from the complexity. Yeah. And that's what we do with these videos, is we stray away from the complexity to the simplicity, and that generates a wow. And then we full stop on the wow. We let it just, don't struggle with that. Once that arises, don't struggle. Yeah, there's a very strong reaction. So that means that we're having a successful engagement with truth here. Is we're able to get to this wow reaction. It means we're able to see the whole situation as extremely simple and easy to resolve. And that for sure is going to generate a reaction. Alarm bells will start ringing. Along with the feeling of celebration. We say, oh my, that's great. And the alarm bells are ringing too, so it's a commotion, inner spiritual commotion arises. Now you can't just force this to all settle down. It's like throwing a stone in a pond. You can't force the surface to become calm. It takes a while to let it settle down here. And there's a retreat into fatigue and sleepiness and, you know, the fear, the alarm. It's like, oh gosh, you can't, you know, that's dangerous what you just did. You saw it too simply. So at this point, what you do is you manage your success. Don't struggle to get back to what you saw simply, because right now it won't seem simple. Because once the wow kicks up, it's like you saw the surface of a pond all smooth and seamless. And suddenly you said, oh gosh, that's scary. And then so you took up a stone and threw it into the pond, and now it's all choppy. Yeah. Well, you know, you're not going to get back to the smoothness of it right away. It has to let it settle down. So don't struggle to get back to the simplicity of your clarity, your simplicity. Don't struggle with that. This is meditation. This is really meditation. Meditation is way more than just trying to be quiet. It's managing the whole situation. The ups and downs. So again, don't be concerned if you're not, if you've lost sight of just the clarity and the simplicity of the insight that you had. That goes with the territory. When you reach it, it will react. There'll be reaction. There'll be a wow that arises. So you just say, okay, that's the price I pay. That's great. And the more you take this attitude, the sooner you'll calm down. So keep your mind in neutral, not trying to remember anything and not trying to plan anything. No remembering, no planning. Just sit here quietly. Don't go into sleepiness. Don't go into action. For me, I tend to get into fatigue. Others tend to get into action. Those are equal distractions. You know, it's funny. In my life, I've been so exhausted and tired my whole life and not able to do hardly anything. That's just a reaction. That's a defensiveness. Whereas others, they're hyperactive and they just have to keep doing. That's also a defense. And I spoke to somebody who was that way. And they just said, oh, it's so terrible. I just wish I could slow down. I can't slow down. I can't stop. And I told them, I can't get going. I mean, I just feel like I'm always stopped. And they said, oh, I sure wish I could do that, they say. And here I've been thinking, oh, I sure wish I could do what they do. They're always able to be all fired up and active all the time, always with plans, of activity. Me, I never have plans of activity. I can't generate any plans of activity. I'm too tired. What use is it to dream of plans if you're too tired to carry them out? It's useless. But both are equal defenses, okay? Equal defensiveness. So in the wow, we try not to be either, you know, tired or active, not fired up nor, you know, sluggish. Sort of neutral between those two states. Poised, I say. We have this poise. Maintain your poise. Like those who are fired up have these high metabolisms. Just burn, burn, burn food. They can eat, burn, burn. Me, I have super slow metabolism. I basically can, even if I don't eat anything, I pretty much, my weight stays pretty much the same. It's like survival. What do you do in a catastrophe? You just sit quietly there and wait till it all clears up, or do you spring into action and desperately try to deal with it, which, you know, may burn you out, right? If there's no, you know, so there's different approaches, different defense mechanisms we have. Being super active deflects our attention very severely. Being sleepy also. We feel like we don't have any attention to give. Those are defenses. So what we do is we consciously, willfully try to stay in the wow. It's not easy. For those who are active, they have to say, no, I'm not going to jump up, do anything. For those who are sluggish, they have to say, no, I'm not going to retreat into sleep and doze off and that. No, I'm going to stay, my mind is going to stay awake. It's a little chilly out here. It's more than a little chilly. It's just the day can't figure out whether it wants to be warm or cool. So I'm going to try to get a little heat, maintain some body heat here. Now you may see pictures of spiritual aspirants, you know, different times and places. They seem to be like they have a shawl, like their clothing consists of like a number of shawls, and they just wrap those around themselves. There's no seams, there's no tailoring. They don't have tailored clothes, and they seem to just be sitting quietly. They're not building anything. They're not making anything with their hands. They're not, you know, making things. They seem to be sitting here like this, you know, with just a seamless shawl, just... Well, that's because their awareness, consciousness, their attention is focused towards truth. And they don't seem to have this anticipatory state of mind of, I'm anticipating something specially good or specialness. And when they're walking, whatever they're doing, they always seem to be happy right where they are, right in the moment. Not pursuing anything. They don't seem to be pursuing anything. And yet they don't seem to be lacking experience. Are we incapable of looking at this? No, we're certainly capable of it. But in a world that doesn't value this, it seems valueless. This is the trouble. We devalue it in our own minds. And so then it seems difficult because it's so devalued. So I would say that the difficulty we have is the devaluing of truth. Seeing truth is not difficult. It's the difficulty is the devaluing of it and trying to convince ourselves that it has value to us. And when I say that this world is going in the wrong direction, I mean that. It is going in a direction of devaluing pure spaciousness, paying attention to that. And it's valuing pursuit of value, pursuit of value. Instead of recognizing the infinite, unassailable value. To put it in Tibetan terms, the Dharmakaya citadel. unassailable Dharmakaya citadel. That vast, unassailable, wish-fulfilling, gem-producing citadel. This world is devaluing it. So when I talk about the world and how bad it's getting, this is what we're talking about. It makes it then more difficult, more of a struggle to put our attention onto this because we feel there's no value there, there's no security there, There's no safety there. So we have this world is becoming more and more arrogant as we go along, actually. You might say it's becoming sophisticatedly arrogant. More sophisticatedly arrogant, which is a better cover for arrogance, isn't it? We claim, well, we're sophisticated, like a sophisticated savages. So it's going in a bad direction, very bad. Not because recognizing truth is difficult at all. As we just showed how simple it is, actually. It's just a simple recognition that it's not an abyss, that's all. And that's all there is to it. And that the abyss was just a hallucination out of our desire to believe we can change reality. But the abyss was never there. That's all. It's just a recognition that the abyss was never there. And then you're enlightened. You're, that's it. You're free of delusion. But the difficulty is in valuing this. In our training has been to devalue this. And it's so devalued in our mind that we believe it is an abyss. I mean, we say, well, there's no value at all there. That's an abyss, isn't it? That would be an abyss to say there's no value. But in reality, there's all value everywhere. There's impossible to not be valued totally. But since we're saying we believe we've changed that, then we're believing in specialness, but where lack of value is possible. So we don't value everywhere at all. And by not valuing that, we don't see it anywhere. So it seems like there's an abyss there. Seems like there's an abyss. So these types of considerations are doing how this is very, we can say this is very, it's pointing to value. So it has this sort of temporary value for us in that it's getting our attention back on value. But the world doesn't value this. And the more the world doesn't value this, the more it seems like an abyss is there. Which just then creates this negative cycle of then defending against the abyss through success and accomplishment and figuring and building and all this stuff. It puts even more emphasis on that. So we're getting more and more and more emphasis in the world on math and science and building and planning and regulating and, you know, all this stuff. More and more and more emphasis on success, accomplishment. Someone moved their kids, someone I know moved their kids, they moved out of a school system here in the Silicon Valley because there are too many high schoolers committing suicide and they didn't want their children, they moved there originally to put their children in this really so-called great success-oriented school system and in the heart of Silicon Valley and then they decided, no, we're going to move out of that because the pressure was too severe. They didn't want their kids having to, you know, go through that. We have problems with teenagers, high schoolers walking onto train tracks here in the Silicon Valley because the pressure to succeed, to accomplish, is just so, so brutal. They just walk in front of trains here. And so there's a big effort to try and figure out how can we protect the train tracks and keep them from walking onto the train tracks. But really, how do you prevent a kid that's being pressured like that if they want to get free of that? They feel, you know, they're stuck in it, culturally stuck in it. So, every time I ask the Holy Spirit, what's going to happen in this world? It always directs my attention to something that points out some sort of cosmic catastrophe. I don't know why. What can I say? I how can I validate that? You know, I'm not going to obsess about it. Problem with the sun, you know, something like this is it's always a problem with the sun. You know, some sort of coronal mass ejection problem. I've always been told that. But what can I, you know, what can I do about that? What can I, why should I obsess about that? It's pointless. I used to. I spent so much of my time and effort obsessing about the catastrophes, coming catastrophes. But what good did it do me? No good at all, actually. But certainly, struggling against the world, you know, what we have to do is to put value on value instead of valuing what is valueless and then claiming we're being pursued by an abyss. I mean, valuing the idea of changing God is putting value on what is valueless because it has no effects. We can't experience it. So we're generating our own abyss that seems to be pursuing us and claiming that's God. It's not. Now, it's possible that there's going to be troubles in the world because of the world collectively may just say, hey, might be a collective suicide of the world taking place. We might decide to wander under the train tracks or, you know, call out to the sun to put an end to our misery. It's possible. Can we do this? Of course. I mean, collectively, yeah. We may collectively just bring an end to this civilization, this world, because it is brutally bringing about this nightmare hallucination of no value, valuelessness, and making it more and more difficult for us to recognize value, where value really is, which is everywhere. It's not based on accomplishment or success or pursuit of anything. So, just like those, you know, those kids in high school, they're like high achievers, and they may just have felt, you know, that there's no end. They no matter how good they do, it's never good enough. Oftentimes, those are the people are most shocked. They say, how could this valedictorian or whatever, how could someone who's so smart, how could they walk on the train tracks like that? It just stuns everybody. Well, how could a world that seems to be so into material success, seeming to be winning in so many ways, how could that decide to walk onto cosmic train tracks and commit suicide, you know? It's like shocking. Why would we do that? Well, it may be that the more you go down the wrong road, the more desperate you feel, and the more you feel you'll always have to be doing this, and you just feel there's no way out. So the world may be all smiley and happy right now and prosperous, but underneath, you don't know what they're thinking underneath. There might be some sort of just dark desperation. They just can't shake it. You know, and all their efforts to be happy just aren't working. And so they may just suddenly walk under the train tracks. The world might walk under the train tracks. This seems to be what the Holy Spirit's pointing out to me. I don't know what good that is. You know, point out the remedy. You know, the remedy is helpful. I'm not going to obsess about the sun. Always it seems that when I put my attention, what's going to happen? I get this guidance saying, go over here, look here, look there, look over there. What do you see? And I look over there, and oh my gosh, it pertains directly to, you know, it's a symbol that pertains directly to some cosmic catastrophe. And just the sheer awareness of telling me to look somewhere, and then there happens to be some situation that is directly, you know, symbolizing very clearly, you know, it makes you wonder. It is really quite something. It happened to me yesterday. I was just like, wow. Unmistakable. Now, can you prevent it? I don't know. Maybe not. Maybe the Holy Spirit's saying, look, this is unpreventable. You're not going to be able to prevent this. And I'm trying. I've been trying to prevent this, really. Certainly, if more people were paying attention to these videos, it could help prevent it, absolutely. Because our attention, we'd be able to look at it and say, ah, now I see what we've been doing. Ah, how easy, you know, it is. We're not trapped. We're not hopeless. We're not trapped. I don't have to keep pursuing success. It's like, wow. But so few are doing that. So few are doing that. I said to the Holy Spirit, Holy Spirit, I'm doing the best I can. If people would watch these videos, they would be greatly helped. And I've done the best I can. What happens? Hardly anybody watches them. I say, wow. This is bizarre. I mean, it's a shock for me. Imagine feeling that you're doing something that you know could prevent the world from committing suicide, global suicide, and nobody watches it. Almost nobody watches it. Imagine the shock of that. That's what I go through. That's why sometimes I have trouble after doing videos. I get depressed. I say, wow, this is very, very effective, helpful, actually, because it puts our attention where it needs to be, and yet it's not. I said, Holy Spirit, I expect, you know, millions to pay attention. I'm doing it. Why not? Doesn't happen. And I say, holy cow, that is not good. That is very ominous. I would expect that when things are getting so bad now in the world, you would expect that more and more people would say, hey, let's not cut out this nonsense. Let's really make a big effort here. But that doesn't seem to be happening. It's more like they're trying to distract themselves from, you know, the It's like any psychiatrist or psychologist or therapist will tell you that there's a time in therapy where it's a dangerous time where suddenly, if someone suddenly appears to be all like, oh, hey, my problems are solved, they're all finished, without actually having worked them out, that means they've decided to commit suicide, and therefore they feel that my problems will soon be over. Now, we just had a wake-up call with that German plane, the pilot, you know, camouflaging their suicidal tendencies and, bringing the whole plane down. You know, this is very symbolic with the world. The world may seem to be fine. Everybody's out exercising, running marathons, being successful, having a career, and yet it's never enough, is it? And still, they're being pursued by this, you know, this ominous abyss. In fact, the more they do, the worse the abyss seems to get for them. And so they put up a brave front to it all. But deep down, maybe the world has planned some sort of massive collapse, sacrifice, suicide. It wouldn't be surprising, actually. But on the surface of things, you wouldn't conclude that. Just like somehow that pilot was able to convince everybody that they were happy, going to get married soon, you know, and have a family life and had the career they wanted and were exercising and everything seemed to be great, although they did tend to become a little erratic just towards the end. And tend to become very controlling, wanting to control everything. Now, what is the symptom of our society? We have control freaks trying to grab control of everything. Trying to tell us what we can think, what we can say. They're terrified of the abyss. They're so frightened of the abyss. They think the only way they can get rid of that fear is to control everybody else. And this is what's happening in the world. We call it the New World Order. And control freaks who have been so negligent of their one responsibility in this world here that they've now got this massive abyss fear that's pursuing them. the more they think they can find value in success and accomplishment and things, etc., the more the worse the abyss gets for them, the more it pursues them. And the more then they feel they need to control everybody else, everyone has to think like them, everybody has to agree with them, everybody has to promote them. And it gets worse and worse and worse. And this is where we're at right now in the world. So the Holy Spirit may be saying to me, look, yeah, the world is going to commit collective suicide, and maybe you don't want to be here for that. And yeah, maybe that's what Jesus was talking about, coming back and helping us relocate. I don't want to destroy the world. I have no desire to destroy the world. I don't need to destroy the world. I'm not frantically trying to escape an abyss, projecting it upon the world or anything. No. Let everything be just as it is. That's fine. So, the idea of dwelling in some nice place, that's fine. That doesn't necessarily stop your spiritual focus. You don't have to dwell in a wasteland to have focus. Remember that we have to deal with our continuity fear. We have to work at this over a period of time. So we need a stable situation, actually, where, remember, our valuing is so, we devalue value is what we've really done. There's only one value, and that's God. And we've devalued that to such an extent. God as pure spaciousness, we devalue that. And we value accomplishment, success so much that we have to gradually change that emphasis. Yeah, we can hardly do that if a globe's committing suicide. You know, global suicide is taking place. Yeah, this makes it very difficult. I mean, of course, if you're already established in value, accepting of it, then it wouldn't bother you one way or the other. But we're not in that situation. What about all the ones who are not yet established in value? It's not helpful, not good for them. You know, panic is not a good state of mind for a spiritual path. Desperation, panic, all of that stuff. So maybe there will be a relocation. I mean, maybe something absolutely is coming upon this world. And you know, the younger generation, many of them feel that there's going to be a big meltdown, but they think they have the answers, that they have the right types of accomplishments that will succeed. They know how to restructure everything. That's just more of the same. Accomplishment, structuring, building, figuring out, managing, regulating. All of this is an attempt to generate value, because we think we've destroyed God, the one value of God. Just God has just one value of pure spaciousness. That is the one value of reality. We think we've changed that, which means reality then doesn't really have any value. It's an abyss to us. Because there's no plan or accomplishment or call to accomplishment in reality whatsoever. And if we think accomplishment is value, we look at reality as having no value at all to it. In fact, worse than no value. It will get sucked into endless no value-ness, which would be like an endless annihilation. So again, we have this terrible negative feedback of fear going on. And this has to be very carefully diffused. Which is why the wise teachers say your one responsibility here is this challenge of staying engaged with spiritual consideration, because you're not going to be able to diffuse this just by intellectually grabbing hold of a concept or something. No, it's way stronger than that. Now, I like the idea of this of a country club, beautiful complex of golf courses and homes, and everything is maintained, and you don't have to do anything. You just get up in the morning and have your breakfast. There's nothing to do, nothing to maintain. Everything is maintained for you. And so how do you spend your time? Well, say, hey, let's convene here in this house or wherever and sit in the patio, and let's all just focus on this spaciousness here. This is my idea of a world. I'm not trying to build anything or maintain anything, or we're not going for accomplishments or awards or recognitions, worldly success, or any of that. This is my, you know, my ideal scenario is to dwell in that kind of situation where, you know, the world, everything is a world that sort of maintains itself. Now, for those who want accomplishment, this seems like you're just deteriorating and regressing back into no value at all. And it terrifies them. If you want a little activity, play a little golf, putter around, and then go back to your, you know, contemplation. Go back to your focus. Be the noisiest airplane I've ever heard. Holy cow, it's almost like some sort of cosmic catastrophe hearing that. That's unbelievable. And what is causing that noise? Air pressure. What's propelling the plane? Air pressure. Generation of air pressure. The air pressure is, gives propelling it, the plane, and the wings provide the lift. That's all it is. You can imagine like some asteroid coming through a large asteroid coming through the atmosphere, for instance. Holy cow. That was just a little airplane going at, you know, what, 400 miles an hour or whatever, not too fast, but an asteroid, you know, several miles in diameter or something, coming through the atmosphere at, you know, hundreds of thousands of miles an hour. What kind of sound would that make? Probably in the past, people, this happens with smaller asteroids, creating this incredibly deafening roar and shockwave and all this stuff, and people think, oh, God is angry with us. That's the voice of God. We need to figure out how to get on the good side of God's will here. And boy, that was a mean, mean sound from that airplane. I don't know what kind of airplane it was. Never heard anything quite like that. So we're just sitting here quietly, and then we think, what help is this? Valuing. We're living our values here. We're living it. We're willing to forego the mad pursuit and continuing to just sit here, saying there's nothing I need to do. There's nothing I need to accomplish. There's nothing, no success I need to find. There's no valuing I need to acquire or generate. I don't need to generate anything at all. And this I don't need to do anything. This let that sink in deeper than what we might think of. Let it mean I don't need to generate any spaciousness. This is more important than the. This is very important. I don't need to produce an identity. I don't need to produce a weight. I don't need to produce a space, a spaciousness. I don't need to be generating anything at all. This appearance is already abiding, absolutely abiding in pure spaciousness, not adding or subtracting one iota. See, that's a normal plane right there. Wow, noisy day, huh? Must have changed the flight path or something. So again, the helpfulness is more than concepts that we're throwing at this. It's more than that. It's the totality of the situation where we're getting used to valuing value instead of valuing the valueless. When we try to make what has no value have value, automatically we then look at what has value and see it and believe it has no value. And since God is value, it's everywhere, it seems as though it's an abyss. We can't seem to locate, you know, it seems like we're being pursued by this nameless, faceless, dreadful, valueless abyss. Automatically we see this, view it this way. If we're pursuing no value as if it were value, then the opposite, we'll see that value has no value to us. And since God's value is everywhere, we will look at it as if an abyss is after us. Because an abyss is the idea of this, you know, no boundary, no place to cling to, nothing to cling to. We can't find anything special anywhere. It's just this empty, vast abyss that will be, you know, just absorbed into, and, you know, this is what God, we believe God is, you know, this is what happens. And then we think that there's a God of no value is advising us how to avoid that, how to be good. And then we got to stay on the good side of the God of no value, our pursuit of value, of no value, as if it were valuable. Because our desire to change God has no value, has no effects. There's no effect at all. There's no experiencing it, no effect. And if we're trying to believe that we're making it have value, again, we're really saying that no value has value or is value. This is really what we're saying. But the overall situation, sitting here, you know, spending time here, even though we're not always frantic, you know, right on point, this is a statement of value, of where we feel value can be found. It's a statement of direction, actually. By sitting still here, we are making a profound statement of direction. It it's a revolutionary statement almost to the world. It's revolutionary just sitting here and doing nothing. Is profoundly a profound statement of purpose. Ramana Maharshi said, sitting here doing nothing, I'm doing everything. By saying nothing, I'm saying everything. By doing nothing, I'm doing everything. Which is the highest kind of type of, most effective, he said, type of teaching of all. Say nothing, do nothing. That's what he did. He just sat quietly doing nothing. But he said, it's really, I'm doing everything. And I'm saying everything. Be nice to come across that. Wow, those planes are very disruptive of the peace and tranquility of an area. Really, really nasty. So again, people think if you have a nice house with a beautiful patio overlooking a golf course and everything's quiet there and serene and beautiful view and you're just sitting there, oh, you're so lazy, you're not doing anything. Actually, it can be a profound statement of doing everything and saying everything and a profound statement of direction and commitment and to value. What is really has value, which is God. Which is all value. There's only one value, which is everything. Nothing is excluded from it. It's all equal. So again, it's really a tremendous statement of commitment and value and direction. Whereas the world may look at it and say, there's no value there whatsoever. You're just being kicked into the garbage dump of history. That's not true. So again, the difficulty that we have, that everyone has, is the valuing. They've got it backwards. So they, our difficulty, we see the value of God, which is not requires to do anything, as not having any value, and the no valueness of pursuing value, trying to generate value, as we see that as having value. All value is there. So when we try to put our attention on truth, we condition ourselves to say, oh, there's no value there, and ultimately we feel like we're falling into a pit of endless no valueness, which would be annihilation, we think. So this is the struggle that we all have, very intense struggle. So managing the path is the primary responsibility. The insights come easily when you're managing the path. That's not that difficult. As difficult is this struggle of fear about values. Where are they found? Where can I find value? And I believe that if we let go of the notion that we have to generate value, then I believe we're free. We stand free. This is what I'm seeing in my mind. This is what we're all afraid of, that if we stop trying to generate value, we won't have any. That's like saying if we stop trying to generate spaciousness, we won't have any. It's the same thing, saying the same thing. And we find out we don't have to generate spaciousness. We're already in it. It's not something we generate. It's something that's fundamentally intrinsic to all appearance. Appearance can never appear without it. So the very fact that we have appearance means we have pure spaciousness also. And that's primary. We can never have appearance without pure spaciousness. So we don't need to generate any spaciousness. And when we can see this and let go of the effort of it, then I believe that we'll relax and that we'll be free. We'll be abiding in non-duality, non-dual abidance. Very clearly, this is so. Now, when will we relax like that, relax our effort? Well, when we're clear enough to recognize this is the next step to take, yeah. The stepless step. We don't need to take a step. In other words, we realize no steps required. We may be retracing the steps we took away from, in our belief we needed to take steps, and each one we retrace, we say, okay, I don't need to take that step. And then ultimately we say, hey, I never needed to take any steps. Again, putting in the time with this is a very profound statement of value and purpose. That basically now, when we realize no effort is required at all, then our creativity seems to awaken in us. And then, of course, we can manifest from that standpoint. We can manifest any appearance we want at all. People think, oh, if we stop doing something like this, you'll decay into cave people. I mean, primitive savages, and you'll have to... No, that's not true at all. What'll happen is we realize... Our effortless creativity. We don't have to create that which generates spaciousness at all. We nearly need to play with appearance. So we can have anything appear we want to appear, actually. Effortlessly so. So it's hardly we're going to be without. If we think we need sustenance, we can have sustenance simply appear. Manifestation is effortless. It's the effortlessness of it that is manifestation, actually. As long as we're denying this, we will keep this, we'll be in the kingdom of this, of the grave. We'll be frantically struggling to produce crops and water and survive. No, it's when we see the effortlessness of being that will be have absolute abundance, infinite abundance right now. We want to have an orchard of orange trees, there it is. We want to have oranges, there they are. We want the fish and the bread, there it is. It's effortless. There's no effort involved at all. It's when we involve effort that manifestation doesn't seem to work. We have to go fish then. Pull the fish out of the sea. And all the contamination and problems that's... Yeah, someone who's enlightened can manifest a house easily. C- can manifest in anything. There's no order of difficulty, really. But of course, we say, well, why don't they manifest stuff? Because we say, well, it has no value. It's a trick. It's trying to trick us into no value. You see, no, only those values only comes from building and accomplishment and putting things together and creating our own space and all this. You know, this is our arrogance. So the wages of arrogance is this horrible realm, like this world where we, everything is difficult and everything rots and is corrupted, and we have to struggle to frantically earn a living somehow and keep a shelter over our heads and ward off illnesses and get enough to eat and just the misery of this scenario. That's the price we pay. That's the price we're paying. So we've been covering a lot of territory here, and keep in mind that your silence sitting here is itself covering a lot of territory. Tremendous. It's like we're traveling in a train really fast. Whether we talk or not, we're still traveling really fast. Just the determination to sit quietly, full stop in the wow, to engage our attention on this, we're traveling very fast back towards value. We say towards as if some place where value isn't. Well, certainly pursuing our arrogance that we can change reality is, that's, there's no value there, but it nothing doesn't have a location. When we say we're traveling back, we're traveling back only in the sense of our willingness to recognize the value is already present, inherently present in all appearance, has inherent value, equal value of pure spaciousness. So by sitting here quietly, we are traveling towards this recognition, traveling very rapidly towards this recognition, whether we talk or not. Now, can we speed the train up? Sure. When we put our focus on flipping the script and asserting, we're speeding the train up. But it's going so fast. And then the wow, we may not be speeding the train up, but it keeps the momentum of the speed that we already have. So it's kind of like that. When full stop in the wow, the speed remains the same. When we're working on flipping the script and assertions, the speed picks up, goes even faster. like a car in gear, have a car in gear, it can accelerate, and then we can take it out of gear in neutral, and it's coasting. Then we put it back in gear and accelerate some more. Just when we put a vehicle in neutral, it doesn't stop the vehicle, does it? Not at all. So it's just when we feel we're going too fast, then we put it in neutral and say, let's just coast for a while. So we coast for a while. Then put it back in gear and accelerate some more. Yeah, so it just turns out to be a cool day here. It's going to be a cool day. So no matter what anyone says, you still have to manage your path and manage your success. And nobody can do that for you. So I can put up all sorts of graphics with sayings upon them and to help out. But if you don't know how to manage your path or are too afraid to or unwilling to, then it doesn't really help. It's kind of like being on the platform instead of on the train. You know, you got to get on the train, which picks up speed. When, you know, and you start going, wow, I'm starting to really get moving here. And this is what it's all about. But sitting on the platform and isn't going to get us there. So again, engaging with spiritual truth is number one. Staying engaged with it. Number two is managing your success, managing the speed. You're going fast. You're getting close. You see the destination. You always say, oh, wow, I'm rapidly getting close to my destination. And then it's like a little bit frightening. Elation and trepidation. Wow. Getting very close. And getting close, as we saw, it's just how we view reality. We can view it one way or the other way. And as soon as we view it the right way, it's there. And the other way, saying it wasn't there, was never true. It's always been here. Just our valuing, our mistake about valuing, made it appear otherwise. And our difficulty is because this world values accomplishment and success and generating the belief that we have to generate this to avoid an abyss. It values that so much. It's very difficult for anyone here to see reality, value reality as it is. Doesn't require any accomplishment or success or building or sustaining. We don't need to make it arise. We don't need to sustain it. We don't need to do anything. I don't need to do anything. No, nothing does. No appearance needs to generate spaciousness in order to appear. That's an intrinsic part of reality. So, no effort is required. I don't need to do anything. I don't need to generate anything. I don't need to make any effort whatsoever. So this recognition, you know, that we get close to this, and this is it. This is it. This is why I call the website affiliated with this. This is it. This is it. Meaning, in our practicing, we're getting glimpses of this is it, and we realize this is it. That's all that's necessary. I don't need to make any effort whatsoever. I need to just drop all effort, and I'm enlightened. This is it. So remain engaged with the spiritual path, and manage your success. This is our sole responsibility here. And if we avoid this, we'll have a return ticket. Committing planetary suicide gives a return ticket. Now we think if we get rid of this world, it won't be any return ticket. Well, there are plenty of dwelling places in the cosmos. You'll get a return ticket somewhere, which will emphasize accomplishment, progress, success, generating identity, generating value, all of this. It will emphasize that. I mean, that's what you want. That's where your valuing is. That's what you'll get. You can't just destroy this world and say, okay, that's how I get free. It doesn't work that way. You've not lost the ability to manifest. You're unaware of it. So it'll just manifest another world for you. There'll be other worlds. And you'll say, well, how did that happen? God must have put this here for me. This is what God wants. This is reality. No, we've just manifested it because we wanted to continue to pursue our arrogance. That's all. God is not a designer of worlds or universes. They're not needed in reality. Reality doesn't need that. Reality is a boundless, borderless, pathless realm with no center and no circumference and no, all is equal. Vision of sameness. How are we doing? Pretty good here. Yeah, we've crossed the two hours here, which is very good. It's very good. And again, doing this is a profound help for you to value. Which is effortlessness. I don't need to do anything. We cannot create value. We cannot create spaciousness. God is the creator of all of value and spaciousness. We cannot create value or spaciousness. God is not flawed. This, the basic structure of reality, the dynamic of reality, is immutable. And so and it's intrinsic. So we don't need to do anything to make it intrinsic or to preserve it. We don't need to preserve God. We don't need to preserve the intrinsicness of reality at all. So giving up all effort. Again, we feel we need to generate spaciousness, and that's our identity. And if we stop generating spaciousness, we won't have an identity. That is not true. So giving that up, that belief, I have to generate my being, then effortlessly we relax into being, and we realize we're completely safe. There's no way we can lose it. Those are the ones that who have done that. It's just relaxed into that. They're fortunate. They're enlightened. They have the great fortune of enlightenment. So others see, oh, they're so fortunate. They have this great good fortune of their just relaxed being, and they wrongly think that somehow God made them special, so they don't have to struggle anymore. They somehow accomplished it. They somehow generated being. That's not true at all. They simply gave up the arrogant belief that they had to generate being. They gave up the arrogant belief that they had to generate spaciousness in order to enjoy appearance, in order to experience. Now, I say, where can we go to find someone like Ramana Maharshi that's just saying everything? Uh-oh, one moment, please. One moment.
Yes?
I'm just going down to the market.
Okay, thank you.
Anything else you can think of?
Blueberries, thank you.
Yeah. Sudden interruption. Let me just go right back to it, you see? Okay, sudden interruptions can happen. And we still, say, I don't need to do anything to be, for everything to be. I don't need to sustain being. I don't need to create being. I don't need to sustain being. Being is intrinsic. See, I don't want anyone to know I'm taping, spending time like this, because they'll say, you're crazy, you're not adding any value, you're not helping anybody out, you're not, you see, you think you're going to fall into an abyss, you're being regressive. What, this is the insanity of the world. This is the insanity, that right there. Now, what we really are is moment-by-moment appearance, and appearance is inherently arises in pure spaciousness. It doesn't have to generate it. So the idea that we would die if we give up effort is not true at all. What we are right now already is just mere appearance. And our creativity is generating that appearance out of our desire. And so, as long as we want to do that, it will continue to appear. But we don't have to be generating the spaciousness, the beingness, the spaciousness that we're appearing in. So giving that up doesn't cause our appearance to disappear. That's ridiculous. That'd be like saying, well, if we give up generating spaciousness for our appearance, that we won't have any appearance at all. That's nonsense, because we're not generating the spaciousness in the first place. And so we'll just realize that we've never been generating it. The whole time, I didn't need to make any effort to generate. This is the realization we have. I've several times seen that, and it's like, oh my God, I've wasted my whole life. I've spent a lifetime of suffering, believing that if I didn't keep trying to generate spaciousness and value, that I'd disappear, you know. So just wasted a life of just spent all this time misery, suffering. But most people spend their entire lives that way, and life after life after life. So at some point we have to, you know, accept our regrets, you know, about just, we've just been doing nothing. Just sitting aimlessly, not even experiencing at all, really. And let it go. Baseball players are funny. They may have a big brawl one day, and the next day say, well, we've got to let it go. Today's another new game today. Just have to, it's all in the past. It's gone. Let it go. So they have that attitude, is what's the past? But funny thing is, they never forget a grudge. The whole grudge is for years until they repay it. So they really don't let it go. They just put it in the background. But down the road, you know, 4 months later, they see the same team. They know exactly, you know, who to get and what their grudges are and everything is. So it's not really, they're not really letting it go. They claim to be. It's starting to, sun is coming out a little bit here. So what was the value in, you know, I was interrupted there. What was the value in that and going right back to this. Well, the value is I was stating what I value, which is value, which is ungenerated by me, which is intrinsic value instead of accomplished value. And so by continuing on with this taping, I'm making a, you know, a huge statement. Instead of springing into action, there's, oh, okay, I need to get back to what's important here. You know, I didn't do that, right? I stayed with the taping. So if you get, when you're interrupted in your practice, in your engagement with truth, just go right back to it. Don't get upset. Don't argue. Just say, I'm not going to spring into action here. I'm going to keep on this non-action, which is accepting intrinsic action, accepting all action, which is intrinsic, which is Ramana Maharshi showing all speech, all action, by being quiet and doing nothing and saying nothing. He says, I'm doing everything and saying everything, meaning all appearances are equally intrinsically abiding in pure spaciousness without any necessity for us to do anything to make it so, or to sustain it so. Just as all dissolving of appearance is also intrinsically supported by pure spaciousness. And the pure spaciousness is always there, supporting the emergence, arising of any appearance also. So the pure spaciousness is equally supportive of the arising and the subsiding of appearance. Let's say we don't want to focus on appearance. It can subside, right? It can subside into pure spaciousness. And the pure spaciousness remains consciousness without object, pure spaciousness without an object. It's always there for the arising and subsiding of all appearance, as well as the sustaining. The arising, the sustaining, and the subsiding is perfectly supported by the omnipresent presence of pure spaciousness. Now I may get an interruption, another interruption here. I don't know if I can get through this one or not. It's getting close to the end of the video, time-wise. Kind of an inside day here in California. Rained last night, so it's cool, windy, cool. Back part of the front is, it didn't rain hard, it just sort of light, very light rain, actually. Now, seeing the arising, abiding, and subsiding of appearance as one chain of sameness in relation to pure spaciousness is what we ultimately will see. This is what we're told. And I'm sort of getting a little sense of that now. We'll be able to look at that at some point, be able to take a look at that. So sitting here quietly, we're managing our success. A lot of wow has arisen. So I'm managing that success. That's part of the, that's the second part of the path, right? First part is engaging, staying engaged. Second part is managing your success. So this continues to be a success as I sit here managing this, my success with this, by not trying to rush too far ahead, not trying to retreat, staying engaged, staying poised, staying interested in this, staying focused, attentive to this. Tiredness tries to come, I say no. The idea of action tries to come, I say no. So we're just sticking with this. And part of managing your success is when you start to feel you're failing, don't quit. Don't say, uh-oh, I better quit now before I recognize that I'm struggling. No, it's to recognize the struggle and then to keep going. Keep going. That's what it's all about. See, we try to be outsmart ourselves and say, wait a minute, if I'm struggling, I better stop so I don't, it doesn't become too apparent that I'm struggling. The whole point is to recognize the struggle and say, hey, I'm struggling a little bit. Let me pick up the pace here. Let me get back into the groove of this. Oh, my mind is wandering. Let me bring it back. Let me get back to the full stop. Instead of saying, oh, my mind is wandering, that means I better stop. Stop this practice. It's not working anymore. No, it's working when we recognize, hey, my mind's wandering a little. Let me get back. The wow is, I'm sort of, I need to manage the wow better here. That's why sometimes it's helpful to say you need to go at least this long on your practice. It's because the ego will make all sorts of excuses for you to quit. Oh, I'm not doing so good now. I'd probably do better if I quit. Well, of course, this is bad logic. It's saying if I'm not trying, then of course I won't be struggling. In other words, if I'm, let's say my mind goes off track. If you then stop trying to be on track, then you can easily say, well, I'm not off track because I'm not, there's nothing to compare to. I'm not off track. And you think, okay, I'm not failing. I'm not off track. But that's by getting rid of the goal. It's like if you, the ego says a way to feel less off track towards the goal is just get rid of the goal. And then you don't feel off track. And we say no, the way is to remind ourselves of the goal so we can get back on track. So the ego seems to have magic, you see. The ego is very magical, and this is what it does. It says it has potent magic. You say, oh, you feel bad, you feel like you're getting off track. I have the magic you need. Just drop the goal, and then you won't feel off track anymore. And it seems to work. doesn't it? Seem to say, oh yeah, okay. But it doesn't really work because the underlying fear of the abyss remains. We haven't reached the goal yet, and so we just stopped trying, and we think, oh, I don't feel like oh, there's no goal, so we can't, how can we be off track towards it? It's a magical thinking, magical belief. And it seems very Zen-ish or Dzogchen-ish, but it's not really. It's not really. Because there is a goal we have to reach, and that is we have to reach the goal of realizing we don't need to reach any goal. But right now, we're definitely in the world is frantically trying to reach goals all the time. And it's that which we must, the goal is to accept that we don't need any of that. And that's a very difficult goal to reach for us. So don't think that the ego is being Zen-like, the saying drop the goal. No, what it means is keep the goal of trying to attain goals and drop the goal of we don't need any goals. That's what it's really saying. So it's pseudo-Zen, pseudo-Dzogchen-ish. The ego can pose that way. It can be very clever in trying to pose that way. And you think, oh yeah, if I go along with that, I'm saving myself a lot of time, taking a shortcut. Not taking any shortcut at all that way. Yeah, because then you get into, I don't need to do anything. I don't need to do this practice. I don't need to do anything. Yeah, I get it. I get it. No. What they're saying is that they're going right back to what they're familiar with, as if that's a shortcut. You know, it seems like familiarity always poses as a shortcut. Saying, hey, you feel stressful and strained? And they say, oh, when you reach the goal, you're going to feel happy and no strain. Okay, I know how to reach the goal. Just go back to what you're familiar with, and you won't feel so much strain or discomfort or everything, and we'll call that good. That's the ego. The ego can pose as a spiritual advisor, seem to be very Zen-ish or Dzogchen-ish, Zen-chen-ish. Very Zen-chen-ish. We call the ego's advice Zen-chen. Zen-chen-ish, where we think, we go back to the familiar, we say, oh, I'm resting in the familiar, as if you're resting in no goalness. No, the familiar is pursuing success and value and goals, trying to generate spaciousness. It's just that we're so familiar with it, it seems like home. But it's not home. It's fear of the abyss. We're so used to it, be it ever so humble. I feel like there's no place like at home. Oh, now I can relax a little bit, for a little while, seemingly. So, you get this Zen-chen-ish pseudo-egoic advice, we think, oh yeah, I don't have to practice. That's stupid to practice. That generates effort. like you say, you need effort to get free of effort. You need to put in the effort to pull yourself out of the insane belief in effort, the tremendous fear that's fixating us on effort. It takes effort to keep our attention on the truth until we finally see through this fear as being empty, has no effects at all, really. It's causeless, non-causative. If the fear is totally non-causative, well, you know, what is there to fear then? So if we're addicted to effort, it takes a great deal of effort to stay, you know, to go avoid that addiction, to keep it from getting hold of us until we finally see that fear is non-causative, that arrogance is non-causative. The whole situation we've done is completely non-causative. There is no abyss. And once we finally accept that, that's when truly, you know, all effort, we realize that we don't need to make any more effort. At the deepest, you know, completely. That's enlightenment. So, Meanwhile, we keep putting in the most strenuous efforts here of avoiding bad habits. Avoiding bad habits is very difficult. Generating good habits is very difficult. So, as long as we're in this deluded state, habits and familiarity and continuity are extremely powerful, and we have to take those into account. Make sure that we remain engaged with the spiritual path so we have a sense of continuity, a sense of familiarity. Say, oh yeah, this is familiar. I come here every day. This is like a second home for me, or even a primary home. We have to keep that feeling of feeling at home with this. Otherwise, we'll feel like a stranger here. You don't want to feel like a stranger to your spiritual efforts and spiritual path. You want to feel like this is home. No, I'm not a stranger at all. All right, so we've done very well so far. Remaining engaged. What's the number one responsibility in this world? Remaining engaged with the spiritual path so it feels like home to you. So there is where you feel the comfort and say, I need to get back to this. This is ultimately where I truly find no effort, ultimately. And the ease of habits isn't my true home of effortlessness. The ease of the habit of effort isn't where I'm going to find ultimate peace of mind and happiness. So I do not allow myself to fall into those habits of negligence. I won't allow my spiritual path to feel like a stranger to me, or me a stranger to it. Of course, the world will help you with that. You know, oh, they're eager to help you with that, thinking that they're helping you generate, you know, an identity which is protecting you from the abyss. They really feel that they're helping you. The world thinks that it's giving you right advice, that the ego's the right advisor to follow, and giving you right advice. And so if you want the spiritual path, it can even lead you into the Zen Chan-ish feel like, I don't need to practice, I don't need to do it and make any effort, I can just continue to do with what I'm familiar with, that everything's fine, no problem. This is, you know, egoic advice. It's like trying to, well, you get the picture. We want that to be a stranger to us. We want the ego's path to be a stranger to us. We want to feel not at home at all there. That's for sure. Pursuing no value as if it had value. We don't want to feel at home with that. We don't want to feel at home with trying to make arrogance causative when it can never be. We want to feel like we're a stranger to there, and it's a stranger to us, and we're a stranger to it. Absolutely. But very difficult to do that in this world. And yet, don't trust this world. It could turn out to be a very suicidal world, actually. It'd be surprising if it isn't. Keep in mind that the world's already brought in great world wars upon itself. And prior to those world wars, people thought everything was great, and everything was going good, where everyone's happy. And you know, I mean, it came upon us as a tsunami, actually. Yeah, I mean, in between World War I and World War II, what was the whole idea? The whole world was saying we were embracing peace forever. We'll never have another world war. League of Nations. The Second World War came upon us as a plague. Shocking. I mean, people are hanging out in Pearl Harbor, Hawaii, and it's just beautiful, beautiful, wonderful. And then, you know, boom. Attack on Pearl Harbor. Americans were feeling really good about themselves, staying out of the World War II, and then Pearl Harbor happened. And suddenly, you know, we were just swept into this in just intensely hideous situation, World War II. We didn't really see that coming. We thought that we're happy now. We've found happiness. So how can you trust this world? How can you trust that it's not going to suddenly get swept up into something?